Hello, can you hear me?
Wonderful, let me look around the room.
Good. So can I just do a quick poll to make this interactive before we start? Who would call himself a developer in this room? You know, you actually write code. Of course, developers include translators and other people, but coders, good. And who's a user, a pure user, you know, translator, someone doesn't code, who doesn't code? Ah, excellent. Then, I have an easy talk. Might as well go away now, then. they're all coders, it turns out. So this is what I'm going to say, I hope. And I will be teaching you to suck eggs, because, well, I'm sorry. So regressions, you know, it's pretty obvious what a regression is. It's broken and it used to work, right? You know, this is the perception of a regression. And, you know, they're thought to be very bad things, and indeed they are. And escape regressions are even worse. These are ones that the user actually sees. You know, they download the application and it doesn't behave as, you know, as they expect. And, yeah. these guys expected the suite to be stable and it somehow failed. Of course, non-escape regressions are bad still, but much less bad. We catch them before they get out into the wild. So this is the normal flow of how you talk about things. Well, let's talk about what kind of regressions you know, we can get. So, for example, you know, it still works, but it got twice as slow. You know, is that a performance regression? Probably. But you know, the problem is that often we have this speed and memory and trade-off here. You know, how quickly you can develop it versus how quickly it runs versus how much memory it uses. So it's quite easy to make it 100 times faster for one user and simultaneously 2 times slower for someone else, right? Or we could use way less memory so someone can actually do something and unfortunately something gets slower for a different user case. So that's fine. So the obvious fix here is to revert the patch, right? Yeah, just revert the patch. But then we get another regression, which is it's now 100 times slower, right? So having done this, you basically can't win. And sometimes my fix is your regression. You know, so some of these things are, to some degree, mutually exclusive. And here are two views that I've heard about how we should structure development and how we should go about this. So I get some very angry people who come and say, first we must stop adding any new feature at all. We should only fix bugs until they're all fixed, you know. And the other view I hear is, hey man, just this is another regression, whatever, you know, I'll do what I like and, you know, just get used to it. And my goals here would be really to help people who are, A, to understand, you know, that actually perhaps we need some regressions. The regressions are not necessarily a sign that we're doing everything wrong. And I'd like B people to think, you know, maybe we should actually invest more time in, you know, fixing these things, avoiding regressions and writing unit tests and so on. So, perhaps moving towards the middle ground. So here are our regressions versus time. These are the closed guys and these are the open guys. And as you can see, there is a slow but steady trend over, you know, however many years to increase the number of regressions. But I'd like to persuade you the line of this curve is not some kind of hockey stick, you know? Okay, you know, it doesn't sound good to have regressions increasing. But on the other hand, we fixed 3,500 plus regressions, many of which never escaped. So you know, we don't actually track. Well, I should probably track escape regressions and draw you some nice graphs, but I didn't have time. So there you go. And we track them and break them down in the ESC every week. We look at the numbers. I publish them on the mailing list so that people can see. And the reason is that numbers often have a positive effect in themselves. So I like to think that by publishing the numbers, we have an effect on reducing regressions, you know, because people don't like them. Unfortunately, when numbers get big enough, people ignore them. They're just too big, you know. And so we then try and shrink the numbers again by saying high priority regressions and so on. But you can see that the bulk of these numbers tell you something interesting about the suite. And I think to a large degree, a lot of work and a lot of use goes into writer and calc. And you know, Impress and Base and so on are either much better pieces of software, or there are fewer people using them and creating problems. Anyhow, so other questions I often get from users is, how can a regression happen? You know, they come up to me and go, oh, it's just unbelievable. You know, these people, you know, it's my right to never see a regression, and I can't believe I saw one. You have failed me. You must be a terrible developer because you have created a regression, you know? And this attitude is not terribly constructive with the developer, because the developer is already feeling bad that he created a regression anyway, right? And so when you come and you say this, they sort of either get angry or they curl up inside and die. You know? So not good. And so I just like to help explain to people how regressions can be caused, and actually that they're not unusual. So I also don't know any developer. You know, we have lots of developers in LibreOffice with widely varying skills. You know, we have people who have just learned to translate German comments at the bottom. You know, or we have people who are doing white space changes, and we also have people who have 20 years experience and a PhD in, you know, C++. And all of these people create regressions, all of them. I don't know any developer who hasn't, okay? So the suggested solution here of stopping anyone that creates regressions from being able to type, you know, taking their keyboard away, will result in no code change, right? So, which will interestingly stop there being any regressions, but there you go. So there is no developer that hasn't, and normally this happens in proportion to the degree of change. The more change you do, the more regressions you create. And what causes them? Well, there are lots of causes, but imperfect knowledge and understanding is it, basically. It is a hard job programming. You have to think like a computer. And the computer thinks quicker than you do. And unfortunately, the person who came before you was an idiot. You know, he tangled the code like this. And so it's just not possible to know all of the side effects of everything you do. So even for a small bug fix, you have to assume many things. You have to read the code and think, it's structured like this, it's called that, almost certainly it does this, so let's fix it in this way. You can't read all of the code and understand all side effects. It's like a sort of chaos theory. You know, the butterfly over there is flapping its wings and there's a hurricane over here. And if only we could find the butterfly, you know, we could kill it and then it wouldn't be a hurricane, you know? Anyhow, so this is some quick examples. These are just not even the tip of the iceberg. You know, they're like a bird poo on top of the iceberg. You know, 3,500 regressions. Ask any developer you like for some very silly examples. So here's a great example caused by a developer who is awesome. Like, you know, so this is not an idiot that caused this regression. This is someone very competent. Extremely competent. And, you know, so the bug is here, you can read the bug. The get export methods actually also create and register things. So when you call a method which is get text paragraph export, you don't expect it to go and instantiate a whole massive heavyweight object and then just return it. It should be get or create, or it should have a name that explains what it does. And so, in a cleanup of the code, someone came and removed these methods because, well, no one was actually using the output of them. It looked like this code was unnecessary, a cleanup. And it really shouldn't have massive side effects. Unfortunately, the result of this was that we lost great chunks of data when you saved ODF files, I think. So you would save it, and then when you loaded it again, it wouldn't come back. But only in some cases. You know, you could test it and it seemed to work fine. But depending on the ordering of what other code was called, this thing would either be created at the right time or the wrong time, and you'd lose some stuff. You know, so some shapes might lose attributes in some documents. And so the fix is particularly lame, I think it's still there, is to call the method get, which actually does nothing with it, two lines. So it's a silly regression just caused by bad naming and, you know, obviously testing was fine, I'm sure. But yeah, unfortunate. Here's another particularly nice thing. So VCL, our toolkit, has a sort of hierarchy of windows. You know, there's like a tree of these things underneath. And when you walk over a hierarchy, you tend to assume things in many cases, such as it won't change underneath, the hierarchy won't be morphed. So as you walk down, this won't disappear or, you know, be thrown out of the hierarchy while you're walking through it. because they won't have any children, you know? Similarly, you tend to think that it won't gain a whole lot of children and then suddenly lose them again while you're walking, okay? And so this method here, called calc minimum size pixel, which is even a const method in toolbox, in fact, it actually creates a whole new toolbox. It shoves it into the tree as a child, as a peer. So it's not creating a child, it's creating another one here, right? And then it copies everything into it, it stuffs it full of widgets, and it adds it to the docking manager, so it's fiddling with another hierarchy. It then asks this child to calculate itself, and then it deletes it all again. This is not what you expect when you call calc minimum window size pixel from the top level. You expect something sensible, right? Unfortunately, this has been here since 2004, right? So this is not a new booby trap waiting for somebody, you know, to catch. And it's also horribly inefficient and extremely dumb. But these things hide in the code if you're not careful. And so all of the things you think are safe are probably not. But the problem is you can't protect yourself against every eventuality. If you write code that capes with this sort of thing, you'll end up with unreadable, unusable, awful code. So it's usually better to assume, get the regression, and fix it cleanly, than it is to try and protect yourself against every available possibility. So here's a performance regression. So LibreLogo, nice little Python thing, good for education, draws pretty diagrams, like good for kids at school. Who would think that adding this toolbar, which is not visible by default, would have a significant impact on startup time, right? So it turns out that the framework code, without putting too fine a point on it, loads all of these icons and interpolates them down with a high quality interpolation from something like 26 by 26 pixels to 24 by 24 pixels on every start, right? It used to anyway, before I nailed it. And before even showing the rest of the UI, and certainly without the toolbar being visible, okay? And you can say that this was really lame code in the framework, right? Well, there is a lot of lame code in the framework, so it could be the answer. But in general, it's good for a developer to be lazy. It's good for them to write simple code and not optimize for cases that don't exist, right? So it's actually good to be lazy. It's good to write minimal code that's easy to read and simple and doesn't optimize for things that don't happen yet, right? So all you can see here is that, you know, we triggered a path that we weren't expecting. And hopefully, now we've got much better performance tests and things, and we can start to see that immediately as soon as it happens, rather than waiting just before the release, profiling it, going, "Whoa, what happened there?" You know. I think the Matic is work actually called this back in the day. And this is also irritating because, of course, it only happens on certain themes. So some themes do, I think, have 26 by 26 icons, and then it doesn't scale it. But others are 22 by 22 or 24, whatever. So. How about bug fixes causing regressions? This is another one. I think this is the last silly example I'm going to give you. And remember, this is, again, just the very small cross-section of silly things. So this reads chunks of PNGs. It reads all of our images inside VCR. And you read out of the stream the next chunk length, you know, so the PNG comes with a whole load of chunks of data of different length and different types. And clearly, someone here fixed a bug. Sanity check for chunk length. If the chunk length is negative, something really bad is about to happen, right? So we'll just return false. We'll give up on this PNG. Unfortunately, the net result of this is that a whole load of images suddenly disappear from people's presentations. Not very many. Not the one you tested. You know, the 100 you tested were absolutely fine. But it's the 0.5% that are generated by badly behaved programs. And this guy instead is my fix, I guess, that truncates overlong trailing chunks. So in some cases, you could put an infinitely long chunk at the end. The last chunk just happens to have a massive length that goes over the end of the file and looks negative if you're not careful as well. And so this guy then says if it's less than zero, it's negative, or it's actually beyond the end of the file, just say it's the last bytes. So we can read the last chunk and actually get your image data out without dying. So this is a great example of a bug fix, presumably for security. that broke a whole lot of stuff and then had to be fixed again, and hopefully it's right this time. But you know, just fixing a bug can cause another regression. That's my thesis. So the idea that we all sit down and fix every bug, 6,500 open bugs or 7,000 open bugs, each taking 1 man a week to fix, approximately, will create, even if we could do that, and it's, I mean, you do the math, like 100 man years or whatever, you know, many millions, tens of millions of dollars, we would create a whole load more regressions, right? So hopefully many fewer, but still some. So instead we have a whole load of strategies to avoid regressions. Let me show you them. So the first one is, it's quite popular in the user community, quality through obsolescence, right? So if change causes regressions, don't change anything, right? So it works, you know, it's a great way to avoid regressions. All you do is you move the datum, right? So you say what we have now is perfect, and so any change would cause it to regress, right? So, and this defining the datum as now is brilliant. You can wipe out all your regressions, you know, just it's where you measure it from. And anything that was a bug actually is now a feature. It's a much loved feature that when you click that button, it crashes. That's just how it is, right? The problem is that people's perception of quality is not conditioned by what we would call a bug. So for us, a bug is, you know, it doesn't behave, you know, as we designed it. But the problem is the world moves on. You know, there are new document file formats. There are new features that people want. There are new expectations of how the UI should look and behave. And saying, well, those are all features. You know, the fact your document doesn't open and that when it opens, there's nothing in it, that's a feature, right? That's a smart art layout feature. That's not a bug, right? But the user doesn't see it that way. So, you know, we have to be fixing these things and we have to be moving on. And we also need to build a community. If you can't change the code, it's pretty difficult to encourage people to contribute. So, stop the world or just fix bugs. This is another, you know, request we sometimes get. So, you know, don't allow any commit unless it fixes a bug. Only fixes a bug, right? And if we do this for 6 months, we'll have just wonderful quality and everything will be fine. So, you know, if we truly stopped the world and didn't let anyone contribute any kind of feature, I think it would have a massive impact on our community and we drive people away. But the good news is we actually already do this. So we have a stable branch. We have the stable branches and anyone who likes can go and fix only bugs. And you can merge those to the stable branch. If that's your mission in life, awesome, we love it, that's cool. We need more people fixing bugs. We need more volunteers actually to care about bugs. And you know, and if you really want something super stable, you can even buy, you know, a long-term stable branch, and you have, you know, loads of years just bug fixing, just for you. The problem is that many people who say this are really just trying to twist your arm into fixing their particular pet bug. So first fix my bug, and then you can carry on adding the features I want, all for free, usually. So who knows? And the other point is that even if we did just stop and fix bugs, it would still cause the regressions to move around to some degree. So those are the negative approaches. There's a whole load of positive stuff happening to reduce regressions. So there have been many talks here, I hope you've attended, talking about some of these tools. I'm just going to whiz through them. But the very baseline was to not have any warnings. And you know, the compiler can tell you your code is stupid. And you know, we should listen to that. And we can then go and turn on many more warnings and find many more kinds of stupid things. We can use CPP check, which can see more things than the compiler, crazily, in many cases. fixing lots of these things, Julian Abbott's done some fantastic work there. Coverity, you know, getting the score down to zero. All of these have a significant impact on quality. We've seen security bugs that don't affect us because of the coverity work we've done. You know, it's a great prophylactic. Clang plugins. So there are some things the compiler can't know about our code base. And the way we use our APIs and the way we're structured that you can't expect a compiler to know. But we can teach the compiler that. Noel, you know, and Stefan have done some great work to create plugins to catch particular badness that we can see in how we structure our API. So as you compile, you can't get bad code. You can't screw up your reference counting. You can't, I don't know, there's just loads of them. There's a great long list of things that we now check every build on a Tinderbox. Human testing. So, you know, a lot of our human testing happens sort of in triage, unfortunately. So after the bug has escaped, someone files it and then we triage it, we reproduce it and prioritize it. But I was actually extremely impressed with the amount of work happening on master. People actually downloading and running and using and testing a master before release. There's a really quite a big effort there. And it's something that I don't think celebrated enough, because these people are doing just amazing work that has a really big impact. And I'd encourage you, you know, if you are wanting to get involved, actually just using and running the latest master build and finding bugs is extremely valuable. And the more frequently you update, the better, really. You know. So every regression is really a compound failure. You know, some developer caused it, probably inadvertently. They're not trying to ruin your life, they're trying to improve things. And all users failed to test it and report it before it got out there, right? So I think there's a dual responsibility here. And there are relatively few developers, and there are, you know, 100 million users. So I think the blame is, you know, it's clear to proportion. So the most ideal testing is to do it alongside the developer, you know? So during that feature development. As I said, I was just really encouraged to see that, you know, that volume of bug fixes and detail points come in from human beings testing it. Bisecting is, of course, really important, and there's a relational aspect, finding the person whose patch caused this, and it's actually awesome. Bjorn Mikhailsson created this thing, and it's just fantastic. And it's important to close the cycle quickly. If we are creating a lot of bugs, it's important that we fix them as well while we have the time and attention, while we have the stuff in our mental set, while the customer is paying the consultancy bill. We need to find the problems we create and fix them quickly. If they come up 6 months or a year later, the whole environment has changed. You know, people move on, and it's just much, much more expensive and difficult there. So if you can work alongside a developer and just follow what they're doing and, you know, test their stuff, that's really cool. What else? You know, testing. Michael Stahl's talk was just awesome. I'd recommend it to you if you didn't see it on the internet as and when it's there. If you commit just a bug fix, you'll get to fix it again later when it regresses. And first you'll get to fix it again soon, and then you'll get to fix it again in another few years when you've forgotten all the details. And it's wonderful to have that deja vu feeling when you see a bug, but it's actually much better to write a unit test in the first place. And then you move your problem to someone else, you know, because someone else's bug fix is your regression, and they get to improve their fix, and your fix stays fixed. So this is just a huge investment, and it's incrementally prophylactic. The more and more and more of these we have, the less stupid stuff we get. And it's interesting, so in the OpenGL work we just did, you know, there are lots of people working on the GL backend, and one of them caused a regression in something that I had implemented and tested. And a weird drag and drop test in Draw found this threading bug. You know, I fixed it in this case, I think, but you know, Mikhailsson found another, you know, some really unexpected good hits from the unit tests. So CPU unit has got, you know, lots of good stuff in it. I recommend Michael's talk to you. So test automation, doing it very regularly, getting these tests to run very quickly, being reliable, and doing it fast. So, I can't spell continuous, and as you can see, my spell checker is not working. great work with Norbert getting the integration testing, so ideally, every commit that goes in hasn't just run the quick unit tests, but the whole battery of tests we have. And, you know, that's happening very quickly, it takes an hour, you know, and your patch can be tested on three platforms, you know, with some reasonable quality. And, of course, the tinderboxes are building with extra checks and sanitizing, you know, the code as well, so. Crash testing. Quailon has talked about this, I think, before, and it's pretty awesome what we're doing there. Performance testing, also important under the simulated CPU. Testing old security CVE documents, you know, without anyone intending to. When we first created LibreOffice and we first built a unit test framework, we tested all the old CVE documents to see if they regressed, and half of them had, right? So we fixed them all again, but, you know, having unit testing really helps. Code review. So there are more expensive strategies than running unit testing. Code review is obviously a very good way to do this. So why don't we mandate code review for every patch, you know, make every developer's life awful and have someone sitting on their shoulder watching every line they type, right? So that would probably improve quality. The problem is extremely expensive in developer and reviewer time, and demotivating and, you know, slows things down if you're not careful. So we reserve this technique for new contributors, people who haven't committed code before, we don't know how their code is. stable branches. So we get a double review for anything that's a bug fix and a triple review for new features. So four eyes have read the code by the time the feature goes in. That's the hope, right? And tested it and made sure it works. And this is pretty effective. Like, it as one of our tools for stopping regressions, this is really pretty good. It's relatively unlikely we get a double regression on the stable branch. Bjorn has some numbers on this. It's of the order of less than a handful across a whole lifetime of 4.4, for example. And the other thing that we use it for is, of course, voluntary input. You know, I'm changing this code, or I'm worried. Can you check my code, please? Please have a little look, advise me, see what's there. Unfortunately, we have very little review bandwidth. You know, everybody is very busy. So finding people to do this is a real pain. It knocks chunks out of people's days. And we really need to be focusing on encouraging new contributors and getting their code in. So TDF is hoping to employ, you may have seen us advertise, for mentoring leads to whose job will be to encourage new contributors and take this piece of reviewing out of the picture. So the experienced developers can be focusing on these scenarios here, which hopefully will grow the community and improve quality. I gave this in my UCL pointer talk. Huge fix, intended to be small, but actually became huge. 61 regression bugs tracked and fixed. 5 of them escaped. So I think that's just a fantastic comment on the QA team, really, that they found all of those bugs, you know, like 90% of them plus, before they actually got out to users. And you know, here is our 6 months of just fixing bugs going on in the pipeline. So 501 had 3 of them fixed, 502 has 2 fixed. So far we don't know of any more. There are almost certainly some. Yeah, and this shows a big hole that Matthew hopefully is filling with work to actually just open and close all the dialogues, find all of the UI and type things into it. And that we're basically missing. I mean, it's humbling to see, we made make check pass just fine with the VCL pointer rework. And for each problem that we had in make check, we found problem archetypes and we fixed all of them, right? So we found that we screwed up this specific thing and we gripped and we even reviewed the code. when you're reading, 10,000, 20,000 line patches, it's pretty tedious, but, being scrutiny. And so we thought it was pretty good, and then used to get in the 60 regressions, right? Which is pretty, pretty. Well, it shows you the hole in your tools, where you're not testing. So what's the future? Well, hard to predict the future, right? Easier to predict the past. But many reasons people don't write unit tests is that it's hard to write the first one. So often, for years and years, Star Office didn't have a good systematic unit testing framework that could do these quick, reliable tests. And it was a pain in the backside. I mean, Quaylorn and myself helped bootstrap that thing because there was such an obvious need for systematic testing. And, once that's done, it's very easy to add a new test, but there was a big chunk of work for the first one. And so the engineering steering committee was asked, and the developer list were asked to come up with ideas for building infrastructure so it's easy to have the next test. And so here are the things ranked by what we thought was important. I'm guessing that Matthew has done D already, so that's great. We can apply our money elsewhere, or we can talk to Matthew, as you like. I'm sure there's more work to be done finishing it up, and hopefully you'll be able to bid for making this just beautiful. So some of these things, so A is what I particularly like. So currently, we there's a whole area of LibreOffice we don't systematically test in detail, which is bad. And that's essentially the area of text layout and making sure that the exact layout is identical. And the reason is that whatever platform you run on with whatever different set of fonts, you get a different answer. So the fonts and the shaping of each language produces a different answer, which is very bad in itself. But we need to create some stuff so we can be sure that given everything is equal, that you have the same shaping and you have the same fonts, that we can actually have predictable layout tests. So my hope is that we'll invest in that. Format validity checks. I have no idea. I forget what these mean. Maybe someone can remind me. Automated help and documentation screenshots. So this was an idea to make it possible to automatically create screenshots for help and documentation so that you can keep the documentation up to date very easily in an automated way. So instead of having a screenshot in the help, you'll have a, it is here in the application. You'll be able to build those things and crop them and highlight the right bits based on what's actually there. So making it very easy to update and check quality of all of those. And particularly to translate our documentation. It, you know, screenshots are very hard to A, maintain, and B, translate. Anyway, it's funny, back in the day, Linux magazine was a German publication, and had this terrible problem that all these English screenshots, you know, they had to try and somehow translate into, you know, into their magazines. And some of these screenshots have only been created once. I was very pleased, I used to work on a component model called Bonobo, and I happen to know that this particular screenshot, just then published in a dozen magazines, never existed again. You know, it was the high point of this thing, and it only ever worked on my laptop. So, you know, you can see that it's a real problem. And we want to avoid this for the help documentation, so another approach there. I'm just making it quicker for QA developers to actually test. You know, there are people there doing bisections on slow and old hardware, and TDF has money and we can help maybe to speed that up. Norma has some boys Green Master ideas to try and make sure that everything goes through CI and it's all, yeah, beautiful, that's right? Something like that. This was for looking for shared library dependencies and Android unit testing. It's extremely hard to develop on Android, as maybe if you've watched this talk, you'll have heard, you know, like a minute to build the thing and push it and run it. And it's extremely unreliable platform too. And you just don't know if you updated your APK. You know, so you can't be sure that what you installed is even the right version unless you manually removed it first, you know, by clicking the buttons, really. You know, the debugging is awful, da 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 da, and to not have any unit testing as well is slightly nerve-wracking, you know, so it's all cloth doing human testing before we ship that thing, right? So yeah, those would be areas I think that we need to continue to build tooling and build automation to try and help improve quality. So here we go. My mission is to make LibreOffice rock, and quality is obviously an important part of that. Regressions are bad, you know, everyone knows this. They are to some extent inevitable. Finding and nailing them in advance, of course, is of course possible, and the automated tooling makes it much easier to find regressions. And part of making it easier to find regressions is allowing us to change more. So my personal feeling is that in order to make LibreOffice beautiful and reliable and clean, we need to do more work more quickly, and we need to do that without breaking the user too badly, right? So my goal for increased testing and increased regression stuff is to be able to fix stuff more quickly and sleep better at night after it, you know? But of course there's a balance here between how quickly we move and the quality, and you know, we can trade one to some degree against the other. So, that is my talk. If I run over horribly?
That would be a first.
That would be a first, yes. I don't know what's after me, but tell me, Mr. Session Manager Person, do we have any questions?
2 minutes ahead, but you can pick.
Who is next?
Me.
Is this on? Stefan. Is it okay? I'm sorry. Any questions? Matthew?
More a statement than a question, but wearing my QA hat, I just wanted to point out that while your graph thinks that there have been 3,500 regressions, we have 5,000 odd open bugs which have never adequately been classified into being a regression or not a regression.
Aha, look at that. So you can get used to classifying bugs and massively increase our regression count. Great, volunteer as a QA member, you know, it's an interesting life. So, yeah, I think that's a good point. There are lots of bugs that probably are regressions that haven't been categorized.
And
then again,
all the ones that haven't been found yet.
And the ones that haven't been found yet. I think there'll be more regressions than that, because 3,500 is the closed number, plus the 600 of the variable, so. I was just getting to that already. What else? Yeah, I mean, if you look at other projects like Mozilla, I did a query on Mozilla recently to try and find how many regressions they had, and you know, it topped out at 10,000, or was it 10, you know, like the number of closed regressions, I think, was a suspiciously round number at 10,000, but the number of open ones was in the thousands, many thousands. So, you know, I think it's expected that we get this ramp of low intensity, low interest regressions. Anyhow, Jeff, thank you, you've been very, very generous. Thank you.